I'd like to welcome all of you this afternoon. I'm Dr. Elaine Anderson, Chair of the Department of Family Science, and so my job is to say very little and to let those who have more important things to say move on. But I do want to welcome you to the School of Public Health's Grand Rounds today. I was thinking prior to today, Dr. Campbell, that I remember when I was a graduate student and I attended one of my very first professional meetings, and this was, you know, way back in the 70s, and the focus was in the early years specifically on child abuse. And so we've come a long way since then. We have further to go, and so we look forward very much to hearing your comments today. So I'm going to turn this over to Dr. Lee Leslie, who's going to introduce our speaker for today.
I'd also like to welcome you, and I certainly want to welcome Dr. Jacquelyn Campbell, our speaker for today. Dr. Campbell is the Anna D. Wolf Chair and Professor at the Johns Hopkins University School of Nursing with a joint appointment in the Bloomberg School of Public Health. She is also the National Program Director for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Nurse Faculty Scholars Program. As Elaine alluded to, Dr. Campbell has been conducting advocacy policy work and research on violence against women since 1980, publishing more than 250 articles and 7 books. She's been the principal investigator of 13 major federal grants on domestic violence and health outcomes. She's worked with Department of Health and Human Services, Center for Disease Control, SAMHSA, NIH, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, the World Health Organization, and USAID, and many other government and non-governmental agencies to improve healthcare response to abused women and other victims of trauma. She's an elected member of the National Academy of Medicine and the American Academy of Nursing. She's also on the board of the directors of Futures Without Violence. She was co-chair of the OIM-NAM Global Violence Prevention Forum and has been on the board of 4 community domestic violence programs, including the House of Ruth. She's received numerous awards for her continued work on behalf of abused women here in the U.S. and throughout the world. Let's welcome Dr. Campbell.
Well, I am delighted to be here and delighted to see this many of you. I'm not going to make any comments on this day since officially I'm from Johns Hopkins University and, you know, that stuff. But it does make me particularly cognizant, the events of today. And why don't you guys, there's some seats up here. Come on. You're not going to want to stand the whole time. This is a story from the Huffington Post, and all you have to do is Google, this is not a love story, Huffington Post, and you can get to it, of the events in January of just this year in terms of domestic violence homicides. And during the month of January, 81 women were killed by a husband, boyfriend, or ex. And there were also men were killed, 12 women killed their male partner. And importantly, there were also 5 children who were also killed just in 1 month in this country. And at least 7 children witnessed the homicide. 57% were killed with guns, and at least 4 of the 86 women were strangled to death. Now, if you actually go to the website and click on each of those icons, first of all, they're related to the mode of that somebody was killed. So it gives the weapon. And it also, the newspaper report for that homicide comes up. One of the women who was killed here in Maryland. 38% of those cases when a woman was killed were followed by the suicide of the male partner. So homicide-suicide is a big part of what happens. And these are just a few of the pictures of the women who were killed from those newspaper reports. You can see that they come from all kinds of backgrounds. One of the ones, the stories that just breaks my heart, is that this family here, the woman and the two twins, and then her, I believe it was a three-year-old son, she was killed. One of the twins was killed, and the three-year-old was in the room when it happened. So one of the things that you think about is, first of all, that those children who either witness a domestic violence homicide or are sometimes the first to find the body, how horribly traumatized those kids are. And what are we doing on a regular basis for them? And then the other thing is, 47% of the women, and if I get teary, it's both the work I do, and it's also I didn't get much sleep last night. So 47% of the women who were murdered by their partners or ex in our National Intimate Partner Femicide Study were seen in the healthcare system somewhere in the year before they were killed, either in prenatal care, in mental health, primary care, the emergency department, somewhere in the healthcare system. And we apparently did not do a very good job in terms of preventing that homicide. And the other thing is, only 4% of those women were seen by traditional domestic violence services. So even though we have really good domestic violence services, many times women who are most at risk are not accessing those services. In fact, I always think that if they were, you know, more of them would have been saved if they would actually access the services. So this is where I started in my career in terms of domestic violence, was in the field of domestic violence homicide and thinking about, okay, so how can we prevent this particular form? Because when women are killed in this country, they are most often killed by a husband, boyfriend, or ex-husband, or ex-boyfriend. So these domestic violence homicides are the way women are killed. And one of the things from a public health standpoint, one of the things we do fairly well in this country is we count bodies. We're not always so good at identifying who killed the person and what the relationship was between them. And the other thing we do is we tend to aggregate women killed versus men killed. And the murder of men happens far more often in this country. It is a big public health problem. But the dynamics and risk factors for when a man is killed, because they are very seldom killed by an intimate partner, are very different from when a woman is killed. And when a woman is killed, prior domestic violence is part of the picture in about 72% of the cases. So how many of you live in Baltimore? Okay, a few. How many of you were living in Baltimore in last spring, spring of 2015? A few. All right. So you can relate with me. I also live in downtown Baltimore in terms of what happened. I'm sure if you weren't actually living in Baltimore, you saw a lot in the media about those events. When after Freddie Gray was killed or died, one can argue about exactly how that happened. And that after that, there was some disturbances. And we, who are citizens of Baltimore, prefer that you call it disturbances or unrest. Because, and all of you are way too young to have lived through the riots in the 60s and 70s. So this was not a riot. So that's one thing to keep in mind when you're describing those events in Baltimore. The other thing to keep in mind is that the violence in Baltimore on April 27th, the most violent day, was concentrated in poor neighborhoods where there was the most starkest health inequities, where the life expectancy is the lowest, where there's the most empty buildings, where there's the most incarceration, where the schools are the poorest. And one of the things that, if any of you were watching television, might have noticed was what happened in near Mondawmin Mall, which is the bus stop where kids who are getting a bus, high school and middle school kids, that take their buses from school to a transfer point and then take a bus from that transfer point to home. And that's that area where you saw kids heaving pieces of concrete, et cetera, available because there's so many empty buildings and falling apart houses in that neighborhood. So there was pieces of concrete around. The other thing that happened was that the police were warned that there were some, what we oftentimes refer to, some knuckleheads, some people that were bent on starting trouble, that they were planning to start some disturbances there in that area. So the city of Baltimore, in its wisdom, decided to halt the city bus service. And so all of those kids from high school were dumped out in an area where there was planned to be trouble and nowhere to go. No buses to take home. So many of them, I would say the vast majority of them, had no plans to get involved in any altercation. They were just trying to get home. But when all of that was starting around them, that became a trigger point. And I have in a later slide the police marching down in their riot gear with their dark visors on, so they look a little bit like Darth Vader, and marching toward those kids. And you know, you think, wrong place, wrong time for many of those kids. The other thing that is ironic about what happened is that most of this was in West Baltimore, that the one thing that happened in East Baltimore was a big fire. Do you remember seeing the cover of the New York Times the next day was Baltimore Burns? That fire was a construction fire that was accidentally set. It was no arson involved. And because, and rightfully so, the fire trucks, the fire department was reluctant to go there in that night of an unrest. There was other stuff happening until they had a police escort, and you can't blame them. So the fire got out of control, and that's what burned. It was not arson set, but the assumption was that this was an arson set kind of thing. So one of the things that we, and who live in Baltimore, come out of this, all of what happened those days in Baltimore City, that we are starting to realize that we have to pay attention to the violence and injustice in our communities. And one of the phrases that I think about is from Judy Atkinson's work, and she's an Aboriginal from Australia, and she has an amazing book called Trauma Trails. And it talks about violence and trauma within her family and extended family. And I think about it in terms of the trauma trails that go through many of our communities. Okay, guys, time to come on now. There's seats down here. And if you have to leave early, you can just sneak out. It's all right. You don't want to sit back there. Stand back there. Anyway, all right. So one of the things that we are talking about more in public health and in nursing is social determinants of health, right? And community violence is definitely a social determinant of health and being more and more recognized thereby. There's also family violence and intimate partner violence that need to be considered as one of those social determinants of health. So public health researchers are getting really good at measuring, you know, how much crime there is in a certain neighborhood and all that kind of stuff. But like the intimate partner violence will never be on those maps unless they go specifically to those kinds of records. And, you know, what's reported to the police is only the tip of the iceberg. Nor oftentimes is child abuse reported on those maps. So people think about community violence as a social determinant of health, but we need to think about all of the violence as social determinants of health. And so if we're ever going to make progress on improving health, the public's health, individual health, we have to collaborate across sectors, and we have to work with communities in terms of working with them on solutions. And how many of you have read Ta-Nehisi Coates' Between the World and Me? Okay, some of you. A very compelling read about what it's like to grow up in a city like Baltimore. He happened to grow up in Baltimore. But many cities like Baltimore have those same conditions. And how scared he was so much of the time. And yet learning to, instead of looking scared, to put on the toughest face, to be all ready to fight. And he also talks very compellingly about parents turning to the belt when they live in those kinds of neighborhoods, and that they often do that out of fear. And we, as public health professionals, are on the one hand saying, you know, physical punishment is not good for kids, those kinds of things, but we're not usually understanding families who are using physical punishment and how part of what's happening in their neighborhoods and in their the norms that they were taught themselves is contributing to that use. So all the messages that we give about, you know, spare the instead of spare the rod, to not use physical punishment to kids, if we're not paying attention to those trauma trails that those young parents are experiencing, we're not going to get anywhere. And then the other thing is, many of those kids then are subjected to structural racism. You know, the history of Baltimore is just rife with all kinds of things that that city did in order to keep our neighborhoods segregated, in order to keep the schools a problem. All of those things very deliberately done by some people in that city. You can see that same kind of trauma trail in a lot of different cities, and not just in the South or up South where we are. The microaggressions that those kids experience on an everyday basis, the violence from peers, the too often incarcerated. And I always say, you know, when we're talking about domestic violence solutions, I'm like, you know, prison never cured anybody who's using domestic violence of using that violence. You know, and yes, unfortunately, some people belong in prison, but, you know, we need to have some other solutions. And that's what the abused women want us to have. Poor schools, lots of unconscious bias, and if you haven't read some of the recent research on unconscious bias, it's very, very helpful in terms of us understanding and coming to terms with our own unconscious bias and seeing it, how it operates around us in structures as well as on individual basis, and then inadequate health care. So one of the theoretical backgrounds that I think are very important is the whole notion of historical trauma. And most of us know from a public health sense in terms of how that's been applied to our indigenous populations, how our Native American populations were subjected to all kinds of instances of historical trauma. And then it's not just the Trail of Tears. And I don't know, how many of you have ever been to Oklahoma or lived in Oklahoma? All right, okay, so Oklahoma is interesting case study in terms of basically how we forced our Native Americans into Oklahoma because it was not a very lovely place. You couldn't grow much. The climate was pretty awful. And, you know, so it was sort of wasted land. So y'all go ahead and go there. Freed slaves, put some of them there too. But then when we discovered oil, we said, oh, we'd like that back. Thank you. And, you know, so you have this patchwork in Oklahoma of continued health inequities, et cetera. And like elsewhere in our country, we decided that American Indian children needed to go to boarding school. That we would take them from their families when they were 4 years old. We'd put them in boarding schools where we would beat the language and culture out of them. Tons of physical punishment. There was also sexual assault of those kids. We kept them there from June 1 to May 29th with a week off at Christmas to go back to their families and a week in the summer. And we did, those kids had to be in that boarding school setting for, you know, 12 years. And then we wondered why they came home and they didn't know how to raise their own families. Why they came home traumatized and used alcohol. And, you know, we tried to blame it on genetic causes, et cetera, and so forth, and not realizing how that intergenerational trauma is part of the historical trauma look. So Solera did a really nice application back in 2008 of historical trauma to urban areas. And I think it you know, makes really good sense for Baltimore in terms of the historical trauma, those trauma trails. Mindy Fuller Love's book on root shock. I don't know how many of you know, ironically, Martin Luther King and Boulevard in Baltimore was built expressly to bring white people in from the suburbs into the state government where their jobs were, without having to pause in any of the poor neighborhoods that were on the way. And that never mind that those neighborhoods, people were separated from their churches, separated from extended family, separated from the schools, and there's no way to get from one side to the other unless you have a car. And, you know, as I said, ironically, Martin Luther King Boulevard, but many communities have very similar kinds of, and Mindy Fuller Love talks about it in terms of root shock. There's also some thoughts in terms of, okay, we've got these historical trauma in communities that, you know, part of it is the over-incarceration, et cetera, that I talked about, and that's a great contributor to our health inequities that we see in those same neighborhoods. So now I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about adverse childhood events. I'm sure most of you have heard of this study. It's a classic study that looked at 17,421 members of the Kaiser Healthcare Plan in San Diego County, primarily white, primarily middle class, primarily employed. It's been replicated in many other communities and settings. Adverse childhood experience, child abuse and neglect, growing up, witnessing domestic violence in your home, having a parent with substance abuse or mental illness, parental discord, that's a great euphemism for domestic violence, I always think, and crime, one of the parents being incarcerated. And so one of the things that they found from the adverse childhood events is that the prevalence, even in this primarily middle-class sample, they were asking them as adults what happened to them as children, high prevalence in terms of the adverse childhood events that they grew up with. A battered mother, 18%. Their own abuse, emotional, physical, and sexual, and neglect. And then one of the other things they looked at is they found that these adverse childhood events happen together. So if you had an abused mother, 95% of those kids also had at least one other adverse event, and more than half had five or more other adverse events. So it all comes together. It's oftentimes the same kids. When they sum them in terms of the trauma dose, four or more, 16% of that sample had four or more adverse events. And then they looked at those adverse childhood events, and all of these slides are available on the CDC website, plus a ton of articles that's been written from all of this. That when they looked at the number of adverse events and things like smoking, and not only early smoking initiation, current smoking, the more ACEs, the more current smoking, the more ACEs, the more chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. The more ACEs, the more severe obesity. So the more adverse childhood events, the more problems with obesity. And you know, some of the mechanisms around that we're just starting to unpack. Unintended pregnancy, highly associated with ACEs as a child. Liver disease, which is, you know, your end problem after substance abuse. Attempted suicide. Major depression, more so for girls or women growing up with ACEs than for men. And the antidepressant prescriptions. And so when you look at all of these different things, the other thing is the more ACEs you have, the more likely you are to die early, primarily of cardiovascular disease. So it's not just, you know, mental health issues, it's not just homicide and suicide, it's cardiovascular disease that's part of it. So part of what people are beginning to explore more of is the effects of these many childhood traumas and adolescent traumas on the brain. And it's well known that the brain, in terms of toxic stress, actually there reshapes some of the neurological actual parts of the brain. And the bottom line is that someone who has had a lot of toxic stress or has had a lot of ACEs, has had a lot of cumulative trauma, then when they are triggered, the cortex is bypassed. So everything we've taught kids that have grown up in those kinds of neighborhoods under those kinds of adversities, everything we've taught them about what to do, etc., if with the hypervigilance of PTSD, and we find high rates of PTSD with these kids, and it's both, you know, a mental health problem and a neurobiological problem. Jack Schoenkopf did a really classic article in Pediatrics in 2012 that they are characterized by having problems with angry outbursts. These kinds of kids are far more likely to be diagnosed with ADHD. All of those things that probably relate to some of those brain changes. Now, the hopeful piece is the neuroplasticity of the adolescent and young adult brain. So those synapses can heal. Those problems bypassing the cortex can heal. But as public health professionals, we want to go out and teach them to do better, right? We want to teach them how to not do dating violence. We want to teach programs of bystander interventions for sexual assaults. We want to teach. And yet, if we understand what's happening in the brains of these kids, unless we do something to heal those brains, we can just teach ourselves right into the ground. And if you think about it, the images, so, you know, the National Guard came to Baltimore after those disturbances. They were called in. And in terms of how that National Guard images was perceived by different parts of our community, you know, some parts of our community said, you should have called them days before. These are our saviors. And other parts of our community, some of those kids, Ta-Nehisi Coates, who would have been there, would have seen these images as triggering of the violence. And, you know, the bad behavior kinds of things. Even though, as one mom said, he knew better. I taught him better than that. And she did, I am sure. But in that moment, he got caught up in that violent behavior without frontal cortex being involved. So then we have the prevalence of child abuse strongly associated in the ACEs studies with domestic violence. And we have for women, particularly the more ACEs, the more likely they are to end up in an adult violent relationship, an IPV relationship. Not for men, but they didn't measure perpetration of intimate partner violence. They only measured victimization. So it wasn't as associated with victimization for men, very strongly associated with victimization for women. So, okay, intimate partner violence. And there's many definitions out there. Many of them, it's any action that causes harm to a partner or ex-partner. Or one of the definitions that I like is that it's a pattern of repeated physical and or sexual assault within a context of coercive control. So the repetition, you know, it's not a one-time push or shove. It's repeated behavior, and that's when we get intimate partner violence. And Michael Johnson's done a nice typology that helps us understand why it is that domestic violence shelter providers see primarily women badly abused, badly controlled in their services, while many people in the community see, you know, they're like, this couple just fights. That's how they resolve conflict. So Michael Johnson divided that up into intimate terrorism, which is much more likely to happen to women. And there's male patterns of power and control. There's less difference across SES with intimate terrorism. In other words, poverty is not nearly as associated with intimate terrorism. Increasing severity and frequency characterizes these things. About 10 to 15% of domestic violence couples in large surveys, if you talk to people in shelters, it's more like 79% of those victims are victims of intimate terrorism. Situational couple violence, much more common, much more likely to be mutual, much more likely to be a violent conflict resolution that you may have, those kinds of childhoods are very much associated with. And more influence of other risk factors for violence. Now, Michael Johnson's nice, neat typology, it's either this or that, of course, as is often times true in life, is not so nice and neat and tidy. When we tried to replicate it, we got much more of a continuum. Johnson himself has come up with some additional categories of violent resistors, who women become as violent as the male partner, but only over time, and a small group of mutually controlling partners. So it's not perfect as a typology, but it does help us understand the differences that are oftentimes seen in couples. The other thing to remember with intimate partner violence, we oftentimes talk about that there's emotional abuse and there's forced sex or sexual abuse and then there's physical violence. And sometimes there's some articles that talk about which is worse, you know, which is more detrimental to your health. And I'm like, well, for the most part, it's the same woman that's experiencing more than one kind. And the more different kinds she's experiencing and the more often and the more severe it is, the more likely she is to have health problems. But there's a small little group, and this is data from Washington, D.C. area. There's a small group that are experiencing forced sex, and this is physically forced sex from a partner only. That's the only form of abuse they're experiencing. There's a 19% were experiencing just emotional or psychological abuse, and that included controlling behaviors. There's a small group that are only experiencing physical, but the vast majority of women that are physically abused are also being emotionally abused. It's, you know, that, again, cumulative experiences that's important. So this is from the NISVIS study. This is also available on the CDC website, which is the best population-based study of intimate partner violence that we have in this country. Notice that the prevalence for men versus women in lifetime domestic violence, about 33% for women, 28% for men, is not significantly different. But when you get down to with the rape, physical violence, and or stalking, then we have a significant difference between rates for women versus men in both lifetime and past year. And the severe physical violence, you get more for women. So they would be more likely to be experiencing that intimate terrorism. The psychological aggression, men say, and that included coercive control, men say they are just as controlled by female partners as women say they're controlled by male partners. And you know, that's something that we in the domestic violence movement, we call it, are like a little uncomfortable with, because we've liked to hang the whole hat on coercive control. But if we believe women when they say they're controlled, why should we not believe men? And those kinds of relationships are not good for you. You know, it's not good, healthy relationships. Injury, though, we find far more injury for women than we do for men or needing medical care. So Ann Coker in 2010 put this framework forward in terms of the health outcomes from intimate partner violence. I played with it and added in the ACEs, because what I am more and more convinced of, and you saw the data that says the more ACEs you have, the more likely you are to be a victim of domestic violence. Those women have that cumulative trauma pattern that makes all of these health problems more frequent and more severe. And you notice that there's a ton of them, that there's death, both from homicide, and also one of the things in terms of women are more likely to kill themselves if they've been abused. We have commonly sleeping problems. You know, so is that a psychological problem? Or is that a physical problem? And when the woman comes to the healthcare problem system, she's like, I can't sleep, give me something to sleep. And unless we ask her, is that related to intimate partner violence, we're not gonna treat that adequately. We're gonna give her some medication that's just gonna be a temporary fix. We have the injury, and we have a great deal of chronic pain. And some of that chronic pain is from repeated injuries, and some of it is from the physiological and psychological effects of being abused. And unless we sort that out in the healthcare system, we're not going to appropriately treat her. And so the more ACEs she's had, the more likely these healthcare issues are to be profound and severe, including the chronic disease, including things like hypertension, which may contribute to that more death from cardiovascular disease. So again, it's the cumulative trauma, and the ACEs study doesn't look at IPV on top of the adverse childhood events. And so we also have more risk behaviors. Women who are abused are more likely to smoke, twice as likely to smoke as women who are not abused. So why do abused women have so much problem with smoking? And you saw that with the ACEs too. What's the deal? Why can't they quit? Why do they have such trouble quitting? Is nicotine a relaxant? No. So we're gonna slap a nicotine patch on her and expect that to cure the smoking. So think about it. And all of you are too young to have ever smoked, but if you ever had, you know that, you know, what do you do with smoking? You inhale deeply, you deep breathe, right? That's what's the relaxant. And many times women will say, you know, that I can go outside, get by myself, and it helps relax me. And so if we're gonna cure her by putting a nicotine patch on it, no wonder she can't quit. And then we're gonna punish her, right? In the healthcare system now, man, if you smoke, I mean, they can do a urine test and get you. And if you've been given a patch, you can get penalized in your healthcare plan for not quitting smoking, the way you know, we as good public health people are telling people they need to smoke. So all of those messages, public health messages about not smoking, et cetera, are only going to go that far if we have a highly traumatized person. So we have depression, as I mentioned. Abused women are highly likely to be comorbid with PTSD on the depression. So we have this hypervigilance of PTSD as well as this depression. And this may be part of the issues in terms of abused women, what I say oftentimes getting stuck without being able to figure a way out of what's happening in their situation. The suicidality I mentioned, and all the suicidality is not just through depression or PTSD, but it's more suicidality. So just, you know, what we usually do is we screen for depression, right? If somebody's depressed, then we check for suicidality. But for abused women, we ought to be checking for suicidality, whether or not they're depressed. Violence during pregnancy. One of the big public health problems in terms of both for the mother and for the child. And one of the things that we sometimes don't realize is it's abuse around the time of pregnancy. So it's before pregnancy, during pregnancy, and after pregnancy. And the most usual pattern is she's abused before pregnancy. During pregnancy, the physical violence stops. Emotional abuse may continue, but there's no more physical violence. Most partners really want that baby. They're cognizant of not hitting her during pregnancy. If he does hit her during pregnancy, you better believe that that's a dangerous abuser. And whether or not he actually hits her during pregnancy is likely to get worse or start up again after pregnancy. So if we only ask her when she comes in for prenatal care, are you being abused right now? We're going to miss all of those that end up being abused after pregnancy. We also have, that's my fault. stop it. the abuse amongst pregnant women is associated with miscarriage, preterm delivery, low birth weight, placenta abruption, STIs, anemia, poor gestational weight gain, and both during pregnancy and postpartum depression. And all of those have been shown in really good, rigorous studies to be associated with abuse during pregnancy and or around the time of pregnancy. And yet, the guidelines just came out for postpartum depression and abuse is not mentioned. I'm like, what? You know, that's been established. So, you know, that's one of the things that where you see those connections that contribute to many public health problems. Low birth weight infants, for instance. So we need to do more research. We need to look at this cumulative trauma analysis from multiple sources. We need to look at ACEs and partner violence and community violence because it's all affecting the same person. And unfortunately, in a lot of the research that we've done so far, we've separated it out. We look at ACEs, you know, what effect that has on adult, whatever. And we look at IPV and what effect that has without considering this cumulative trauma. And some of those physiological effects have not been totally sorted out. That's okay. It's fine. I understand. So one of the things that we're starting to figure out is that the abuse affects the stress response, that HPA axis. How many of you have taken physiology lately? A few. All right. So HPA axis is the stress response, hypothalamic pituitary axis. What also happens, though, this goes on in the brain in terms of our stress response, and we get PTSD and psychological response, but our immune system is also affected. And we get immune system dysfunction, and the immune system can be activated and or suppressed. So And I used to think it was one or the other, but it's not, of course. It's more complicated than that. And so we've seen that with some of the child abuse. Again, we haven't done the lifetime trauma kinds of looking at that. But how much does that go towards some of those health effects? One of the things that happens if you're overweight is, or you know, the BMI is high, is an inflammatory response contributes to the overweight. And you remember in the ACEs, people who had experienced adverse childhood events were more likely to be overweight. We also see overweight amongst abused women. So this is some fancy stuff. Jessica Gill did some of this in terms of trauma, PTSD, HPA axis alterations, health declines just from that, but particularly around some of the immune system alterations. And another place where this gets applied is with HIV. We know in this country that domestic violence and HIV is very much connected. We have talked about how it's impossible to negotiate safe sex if you're in a relationship where your partner hits you. And that also the women are oftentimes are afraid of being beaten if they get tested, if they come home with the testing results of HIV. Women are oftentimes accused of infidelity. What have you been doing that you brought HIV into our relationship? And when it's actually much more often to be the male partner who's having other partners unknown to women. But we also have the relationships, more trauma, more substance abuse, so the substance abuse connection with HIV. But what we're only beginning to look at is that immune system alteration. And one of the things we know, the more abused you are, the more likely a woman is to have STIs. And that STIs activate the AIDS virus, and it goes zipping on through the vaginal wall. If there's an STI that's activated the immune system. And so, you know, and I never forget seeing a slide of that, and I was like, whoa, youch, because usually the vagina has some barriers against HIV. And so part of the forced sex that we see with domestic violence is forced anal sex, not to be graphic, but that's a perfect portal for HIV transmission. So we have a great public health model for the intersection of HIV and violence for women. All the behavioral risks, all the, you know, women less likely to be a consistent condom user. But we also have now that physiological evidence that adds to it, that that's part of the picture. So this immune system alterations also can affect women once they're HIV positive. And in a recent dissertation that Jacquelyn Anderson did, she found that women who had HIV, if they were abused by a partner, had decreased CD4 counts, you know, so less immune function, and an increased viral load. So their system, their bodies were less able, even with antiretrovirals. And these were with women that had antiretrovirals, who were keeping their, you know, they were adherent to their meds, they were doing everything they're supposed to. But that partner violence was continuing to affect their system. Eddie Machtinger's just published a really compelling study of deaths amongst HIV-positive women, and we have way too high rates of death amongst HIV-positive women in this country compared to where we should be, where antiretrovirals are available for everyone. And Eddie found that there were 14 deaths in 6 months, some from homicide, some from suicide, some from complications of AIDS. And the one common denominator amongst all those women is they were being abused by their partners. And they were all in an outstanding HIV clinic. So although this physiological stuff is not totally sorted out, we're starting to look at it. And one more source of health problems for abused women is, what about the trauma trails of traumatic brain injury? So the more we know about child abuse victims in terms of shaken baby syndrome, the ones that live through that, you know, that's not good for heads, not good for brains to be shaken. So that may, and children that are abused get hit in the face and in the head, and so they have that physical injury to their face. We know about CTE with our football players. Our boxers, we know that they're highly likely to have neurological damage. And I'm a big football fan, and you know, like I've been watching the games, and still guys are slapping each other on the helmet. I'm like, don't do that. It's not good. It's the cumulative hits. It's not just the one concussion. It's the first and second and then little hits that contribute to the CTE. And so we find also with offenders of intimate partner violence more likely to have had head injuries, traumatic head injuries. And we find women who are have been complaining, and this is a study I did many, many years ago, in terms of women who are abused having more symptoms, central nervous system, neurological symptoms, than non-abused women. So what was that about? We weren't sure then, but I'm sure that a lot of it was through these head injuries. So we find that women who are abused have more strokes than women who are not abused, and symptoms of strokes. And you know, and have we, when women come in with symptoms of a stroke, especially if she's young, do we necessarily assess for intimate partner violence? No. We also find increased strangulation amongst abused women, and strangled oftentimes to unconsciousness. So we also find that women are more likely to get Alzheimer's at an early age, and the Alzheimer's decline is quicker. And my kids say, Mom, you see domestic violence everywhere. And I say, yeah, I know. But you know, maybe a small part of that may be related to that. And I was invited to NIH to a big confab on why women are having more Alzheimer's disease. And one of my colleagues said, I guess it can't be hormones, can it? You know, darn, you know, they always like to put it on hormones. So we find that, and there's been some recent publications by some other people that showing cognitive decline in abused women. You know, this is the TBI picture. So it's not only if you get hit here, it's the rest of the brain has problems. So there's other parts of the brain that get affected by the blood barrier disruption. And the choking piece in terms of is another form of lack of oxygen to the brain. It's called anoxia, and which is also not good for brains. So we wonder why we have not only an increased risk of homicide with choking, but also an increased risk of other central nervous system symptoms. So this is just data from a study we did in Baltimore City in a primary care clinic. We had 27% of women, and they were not coming in because they were abused. They were just coming in for their regular health care, but we asked them about abuse. 27% they said they had been choked at least once by their partner. And this is just a regular sample of abused women, much higher prevalence in women who come into shelters. 8% had at least one head injury or a facial fracture, some sort of a fracture to their face. And 6% had had at least one head injury from abuse with loss of consciousness. So, you know, these are women that the next time they come into the ED with a black eye ought to be assessed for traumatic brain injury, ought to be assessed for a post-concussion syndrome. So we found the women who had experienced those head injuries or facial fractures or choking were more likely to have neurological symptoms, more frequent neurological symptoms, things like headaches, seizures, trouble concentrating, difficulty remembering things. You know, those kinds of cognitive issues that, and then oftentimes, you know, in the healthcare system, we say, oh, those abused women can't prioritize, can't remember their appointments, you know, can't figure out what to do. What's wrong with them? Rather than finding out what kinds of injuries they've had. So Lori Heise has done a really nice model in terms of primary prevention of domestic violence from a public health standpoint and all the different places that we need to work on that in terms of our norms around violence, around male-female relationships. We need to look at individual families. We need to prevent the child abuse that's so associated witnessing domestic violence with using it as adults. We need to work on our teaching practices in terms of prevention of dating violence, et cetera, empowering women and girls as part of the approach. And this is, of course, from a global kind of standpoint. But I would also say, and from a global standpoint, we are doing some things in terms of things like trauma-informed community development in Pittsburgh. They're thinking about that. Safe streets initiatives in terms of interrupters being assigned when there's been a shooting to help the person who's been shot, usually a young man, who's been shot, not either do some sort of revenge shooting nor be the victim of another form of violence. And so that's oftentimes happening in some of our hospitals, and we're starting a program like that at Hopkins. Trauma-informed schools, there's some trauma-informed schools in DC. At the University of Maryland, there's a care clinic for abused children and also children who witness domestic violence. There's trauma-informed substance abuse programs. The VA is starting to do trauma-informed offender intervention programs. And the Strength at Home program that Casey Taft developed has been a clinical trial, NICE RCT tested. It's the only offender intervention program for domestic violence that has been shown to reduce repeat use of violence, and it also reduces PTSD. So that's the one that's really trauma-informed, and that's the kind of thing we need in the civilian world. Parenting programs that have trauma healing components. Leanna Nguyen is our Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City, who's doing a lot of different programs, combining a dating matters or a dating violence prevention program with a youth violence prevention program using the interrupters. But we need to do trauma-informed STI clinics. And we need to think somewhat differently. Rather than the old models of primary prevention, secondary prevention, and tertiary prevention, and different people are supposed to do it. You know, primary prevention, public health folks are out there doing primary prevention. Those of us in the healthcare system, we're doing secondary. And then there's the tertiary prevention people that are hopefully preventing the homicides. So we need to think, these are all the same people oftentimes. There's oftentimes our offenders were victims as a child. And so we need a multi-generational kind of approach, a multi-sectorial approach, and we need to think about prevention as healing, that there needs to be a healing component with our prevention programs. And one of the things, in terms of those of you that want to get an MPH or a PhD someday and do research, one of the things we're really good at is we control for things like poverty. We control for things like a violent neighborhood. We control, because we're like, well, we can't fix poverty, so let's control for it, make it go away in our analysis. So we never know how much effect it has. And that's in our, you know, new approaches to social determinants of health. And look, the next time you're assigned a research paper to read, look for what they control for. And it means it goes away in the final results, that it can't influence what happens. And we talk about unequal access to healthcare. It's more than unequal access. It's actually making people if it's a trauma-informed care, want to go see their physician versus being subjected in our healthcare system to massive, you know, microaggressions and unconscious bias. So we need programs that that heal as well as teach. And I mentioned the strength at home. Our prisoner reentry programs, we have a lot of prisoners reentering our system, our communities in Maryland. You know, what are we doing in those programs besides getting jobs? Yeah, we need to get them jobs. What are we doing in terms of some of the healing work? Secondary intervention in the healthcare system. All right, how many of you young women have been for your well woman visit? All right, so did they ask you about domestic violence? Some yes, some no. Okay, so they were supposed to. It's a covered service. So if you go and you're not asked, say, yo, weren't you supposed to ask me about domestic violence? They will probably say, well, I didn't think you looked like somebody who was abused. Yeah. You know, so how would they know? So those of you that were asked, did they ask you well? A questionnaire?
Not followed up upon after submitted.
Right. Oh, a questionnaire, no follow-up. Okay, did anybody ask out loud? Okay, so did they look at the computer screen the whole time, or did they actually they looked at the computer screen? You know, good place to hide behind. You know, so one of the things is help our providers, you know, say if they asked, say, I'm glad you asked, but you could have looked at me. But give them a pat on the back, because this is all new to them. They're not exactly sure how to do it, and they're afraid you're going to be offended. And you're going to say, why are you asking me if I'm abused? So we need to give them a pat on the back. We need to help them ask better so they do a better job with this. But they are starting to do it in the VA. They're piloted in here in Baltimore, and it's going to four more sites are joining on. They're asking everybody, male and female, are you experiencing partner violence? So they're not saying, are you a victim, which is, I think, useful. And they're not saying hit, slap. But are you experiencing partner violence? And are you using partner violence versus are you an offender? Are you, you know, hitting your wife or girlfriend or boyfriend? So, you know, that's part of it it's going to be interesting to see how all of that sorts out. But it's a new approach. So there's good evidence that there's good screening tools that work. That it's safe, that women want to be asked. There's good evidence that we need to change our whole system when we ask about domestic violence. It's not enough to just do the asking. There has to be follow-up when you put in a form. And Futures Without Violence, which you heard I'm on the board of, is an awesome site to go to for both a lot of prevention materials, but also for ways to incorporate asking and warm referrals in the healthcare system, in family planning, and in other parts of the healthcare system. The warm referral notion is that I, as a provider, if you tell me I'm abused, I offer to make the phone call with you. I don't just give you a number. You know, I offer, and I can say, and I know somebody in social work, and she really understands this stuff, and she's really good with people. We could call her together versus here's the number, make an appointment. You know, so that's a very different kind of approach. There's also, SAMHSA has a great website in terms of the trauma-informed care that we can offer people that helps heal that trauma. And there's 17 interventions for lifetime trauma that have been tested and found to be effective. I do think we need to think a little bit about exactly how we tailor these and offer these. I oftentimes think, you know, if in our schools we said, okay, you know, in our middle school we said, all of you that have been abused by your parents, report at 3 o'clock for yoga. You know, you're like, yeah. You know, wonder how much uptake you're going to get on that. So we have to make sure that these activities are tailored. Tai Chi is one that oftentimes young people find very exciting and has elements, if it's taught right, healing from trauma. So there's many different things that have been done, and they're useful. The research agenda has to address this, and this is a busy slide that talks about when a person is abused in the healthcare system, and this is either a man or a woman, and of course we have same-sex and all across the LGBTQT continuum violence in those relationships too. But so when someone is abused, that we need to find out about ACEs, whether or not they've had the adverse childhood events, and understand that some of their healthcare problems may be related to both injury, IPV, childhood trauma, if that's been part of it, other kinds of community trauma. And that on the safety process, we do need to talk to her about possible safety planning. We need to get her in touch with domestic violence resources, places she can get safety planning, and there's 800 numbers. There's a text function for the adolescent abuse number. But also, we need to work on the health part. And we need to take a trauma-informed approach to her health problems, as well as working on the safety parts. So the danger assessment is something that I developed many years ago that helps women identify how much, how severe her danger of homicide is if she's abused. It's been tested, and it's now incorporated in a couple of really cool apps. The apps were developed by Yardley Love's mother, and I don't know if you remember Yardley Love's case, but she was the lacrosse player who was killed by her boyfriend at UVA. Yeah, you remember. And one of the things with Yardley was that she broke up with the young man before he killed her. And he sent her a ton of nasty emails threatening, saying, "You should have died that night. I should have killed you when I had a chance." And she showed those to her friends. And her friends said, "Oh, yuck, Yardley. Good thing you're breaking up with him. Good thing you broke up with him. Good thing you're going to graduate soon and you won't have to see him anymore." Nobody said, "Ooh, that's really scary." And so this app, the My Plan app, is meant to be used by family or friends of somebody that they're worried about in a relationship. It's on the apps, it's in the App Store, both kinds. It's also available through the One Love Foundation website, www.joinonelove.org. And it also goes through, the danger assessment is embedded in it. It also asks about her priorities. What do you want to do with this relationship? You want to keep it? Do you want to dump it? You're not sure? We get a lot of not sures. It also asks women, what are your priorities? If you're in school, are your studies your priorities? You have a job, if that's your biggest priority, and you can prioritize the different things. If you do you have children? Are they your priorities? So then the safety planning that comes out of this algorithm, the combination of the amount of danger in the relationship and her priorities, her choices in terms of what she wants to do with the relationship, all are put together with some individualized, tailored safety strategies. That a friend can get for her and show her, or ideally a friend can go through it with her, and she can go back and do it again and do it again when things, or if things change. So that's one of the promising interventions. There's also a Dove intervention that's embedded in home visitation that was just published that was shown to decrease repeat domestic violence. There's some combination HIV and IPV interventions. Judith Bass did a nice intervention using community health workers for PTSD that was successful. Decision Aid that Nancy Glass has developed, and also iHeal in Canada, which is another online decision aid. So people are working on this, and now we see if I can actually, this is very short, I promise, click on this. Ta-da! All right. So this is the Defending Childhood website that has, this is a picture, you know, it's like a picture of your brain on drugs, except this is a brain that's been affected by trauma. zoom now if I can make it roll down. And these are some things that can heal with kids, that anybody can do to celebrate kids. Use put-ups, not put-downs, and there's more about the science. Comfort, that you can collaborate with kids, projects together, listen to kids, inspire kids, and look at what happens to the brain. And then there's some really nice little videos on science, some really nice videos in terms of what people can do to take care of these issues. Now, how do I get back?
PowerPoint.
You can do that. Aha. Brilliant. Thank you. So, finally, the prevention of healing, the notion that we do healing as well as cognitive kinds of things, that we work on things like the massive incarceration and prisoner reentry, that incarceration can't be our only solution for communities. Brian Stevenson's book, Just Mercy, is another compelling read. And one of the things that I oftentimes wonder is, are we holding men of color more accountable? We talk in domestic violence, we're going to hold abusers accountable. So are we holding men of color more accountable than we are white men? And although the study has not been done, I've been trying to figure out how to do it, I betcha that there are more men of color that have been incarcerated for domestic violence than there are white men. And this makes women in some of those neighborhoods in Baltimore City very reluctant to call the police, because, you know, heaven only knows what's going to happen to her partner. And she wants him to stop hitting her, but she doesn't necessarily want him in jail. She certainly doesn't want him to be another Freddie Gray and end up dead. And so, you know, it's a real nexus in terms of her safety, her kids' safety, decision making around those issues. The offender intervention programs need to be more than just cognitively based. We need to build on the strengths of our communities. We need to go find out what are the strong places in our communities? What kinds of, do we have a strong veteran community? Do we have a strong faith community? Do we have strong and extended families that can be helpful with these things if they just knew how to be? Most communities cherish their children. So we go at this in terms of how do we make sure that children don't grow up using violence. A strong will to address the inequities in our communities. The traditional healing practices have been found to be useful. We need to test them. We need to help those of us that have white skin. We need to acknowledge our privilege. And we need to help our colleagues who also have white skin acknowledge theirs. And the new recognition of masculinities in terms of the norms of being men. And in order to do all this, we need to engage boys and men in the issue. And I'm really pleased that there's this many young men here. I urge you to become involved. And there's various ways you can become involved. And there's Futures Without Violence has some good stuff. The Coaching Boys into Men program from Futures Without Violence is a nice one in terms of teaching young men how to be nonviolent, along with lessons of how to hit the ball and how to kick the ball and how not to get their brains scrambled. So anyway, I want to end up here. This is a mom from Baltimore. Her daughter was involved in our domestic violence homicide study. And she said, if you're ever going to talk about the data that you got from me, you need to say that. So I did. Thanks.
We have about 15 minutes for questions.
You know, one of the things that all campuses are working on now is the sexual assault stuff. And we really need all of you engaged in that in terms of how to do those sexual assault prevention initiatives that don't demonize young men. I always think, if we had classes that were like how to have great sex, would be more effective than, you know, how to not sexually assault, you know, issues of consent. You could weave that right in there. But anyway, that's just a side. Yes?
Could you talk a little bit about, because you talked some about some measures that we now have, and the different places where perhaps these measures could be used. From your experience working in the healthcare system, too, could you talk a little bit about the, not only just the prevalence of which these interventions are utilized, but how we can perhaps try to make their utilization become more normative.
Right.
So that you don't, you know, when you're asking, has anybody experienced that, you know, it's more normative for the person who's asking the questions, but also more normative maybe for the person who's being asked to answer them.
Absolutely.
And we encourage healthcare providers to do a little spiel before they ask the question. We do encourage people to ask face-to-face, but we can also do it on an ACOSI kind of a way. But some little spiel that says, because partner violence happens to so many people in this country, we ask everybody these questions. Or because domestic violence affects the health of so many men and women in this country, we're asking everybody these questions. Mm-hmm. So there's some little normalization kind of thing. And then, of course, you know, the SAMHSA, you know, things, it oftentimes depends on your insurance. And a lot of the really effective treatments for PTSD take many sessions to get there. And if you're on Medicaid, you get 2 mental health sessions per year if somebody can get you in. You know, so, you know, there's that. Unequal access. It's not, you know, total inaccess, but it's a lack of access to some of the interventions that would be the most useful. And so again, we need to think about what makes sense for, you know, like we've got, say we have an overweight woman who is smoking and is pre-diabetic in the healthcare system, and we do ask about domestic violence, and indeed there's an abusive partner, ex if not current, there was ACEs, and so then what? You know, and many healthcare providers are like, well, does that mean just the meds ain't gonna work? You know, and they're not sure they really wanna know the complicated stuff unless they've got a good roadmap in terms of what might make sense for her in her life with her children. And so that's, you know, part of the complication of all of it. And so we need providers to get a little bit more comfortable in talking to people in terms of you know, what's happening. That's why that website I like in terms of what's happening in the brain, it's made quite not only graphic but easy to talk about. So that we can, like, help parents whose kids are having problems acting out in school. Yes?
But it sounds like for those providers, they need to get comfortable. They need to know where
right.
they can refer. Provider.
They've
got to have a network.
Right. Provider education is really important. People are working on embedding it in the EMR, the electronic medical record, so that you not only have to ask, but then, you know, if you get a yes, you're supposed to do this. But again, if it's a script that you read without looking at the person, you know, that's not going to be particularly effective. But maybe after you read it a dozen times, you'll get more familiar with it and more comfortable with it. But, you know, definitely provider education is part of one of the things that people are trying to work on. Yes, ma'am.
So I was going to ask you also about best practices and opportunities for assessing someone who's being abused or and intervening. And you mentioned what we were asked at our well woman visit about it. Well, I had a wrist injury and visited the ER earlier this year and was asked a few questions about whether I'd been the victim of violence. I don't think they used the word victim, actually.
If I was in safe at home.
But it was really interesting because I was sitting right there with my husband.
Yeah, right.
And I was thinking, great. You know, like if I were in fact experiencing anything,
right. And that's the kind of thing we need to point out to providers. Yo, I know. And people just, you know, they're just not thinking. And so, you know, we need to help them think. And that's why the system change kind of thing has to be put in, so that there's a system around when people are separated from their family as part of a normal ED visit. And that, you know, and at that point, that's when you can ask some sensitive things.
The second part of what I wanted to ask was that I was really very saddened by, there was a graduate of our school, a young woman who was killed by her ex-boyfriend last year in Montgomery County.
Yeah.
You know, she was someone of African descent who was from an immigrant family killed by her white ex-boyfriend. You know, and it was one of those things where, of course, I didn't personally know her, but it made me think a lot about all the points of contact that our students have here,
right.
And you know, what kinds of things are in place with how can we identify these situations,
right.
And potentially intervene.
Right.
And one of the things that we try to do is make sure our student health system is also doing that same kind of screening. And of course, the screening is not the traditional surveillance kind of screening that's, you know, in the public health model. It's to create an opportunity. And one of the things we find is if there's posters in the healthcare setting that says some things about abuse, that first of all, that gives you a clue that somebody might be asking about abuse, and it also gives you some places you can go. You know, if you have the name of the app there, you know, on a poster, so you can pick that up without actually having to talk to your provider, even though they ask, you may not be willing to disclose. But the more places we have like that, the better. In terms of and you know, my colleague Nancy Glass developed the app, but I think the app is really an amazing resource for college age kids, and that's who it was designed for. Yeah. Just get the word out. Yes, ma'am.
So I was recently asked to review an article, a manuscript about IPV and whether genetic counselors should be asking questions about IPV.
Good question.
Given like this anonymous survey to the participants, but there was no follow up to the survey, and I was like, if they had current experiences of violence right now, how did you follow up? So I raised that as an ethical issue in their research, and I wanted to ask you as a researcher and a clinician. How do you integrate some of those interventions and those kinds of the healing into the studies that you're
doing? Yeah, the studies.
And we work on that really, really hard. We always offer referrals to people, either, and if it's a written survey or an online survey, there's a section that, you know, here you can go here, just click on this if you'd like to read more about resources that are available, you know, for anybody, whether you said yes or no. In terms of follow-up, we always do a separate consent for any kind of follow-up. And one of the things here at University of Maryland, I know they do because every university has to do a sexual assault survey. And one of the things we did in our sexual assault survey is we did some in-depth interviews afterwards with people that volunteered. That really gave us a lot of insights around some of that, and some of those people that had disclosed sexual assault, and those were both men and young men and women, were actually then wanted to get involved in some of the prevention efforts as well as get some counseling, et cetera. But you have to make sure that your system has good counseling. And, you know, one of the things we struggle against with the sexual assault arena is in terms of the mandatory reporting and all the Title IX provisions and all of those kinds of things. But, you know, unless we have students who get these things fixed, you know, we'll be blundering along in that whole arena trying to obey the law, find out how much of it goes on. And so many of the sexual assault surveys have like a 10% response rate. So, you know, how much is that telling you, really? And so part of it is, you know, getting a lot of people to take part in those surveys when they're offered. And I know you guys get bombarded with surveys. So anyway, but those are some ways, you know, we can, and that our bystander interventions on college campuses, a lot of places have bystander training, need to talk about partner relationships as well as the more traditional sexual assault. In our sexual assault survey, for instance, we found that more than half of the sexual assault was partner sexual assault. And, you know, the partners were, you know, first date, some ongoing partners, some, but it was, there was some sort of relationship going on between the people. It wasn't a stranger assault. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't an intoxicated party kind of thing that we oftentimes think. Another place on the sexual assault is many young women will go for emergency contraception, you know, and without actually disclosing sexual assault, or they may not even be figured out in their own head exactly what it was about, but I know I need emergency contraception, that much I know. And so again, that our student health settings are offer services for possible sexual assault. Okay.
So I want to thank Dr. Campbell for being here. Let me say a couple of things. She has given us so much to think about, so many links, so many, you know, websites. All of her PowerPoint will be posted on the Family Science website. I don't know if any of you were frantically trying to write.
Yeah, we were supposed to tell you that to start, but yeah, we forgot.
Don't need to do that. So you can just go to the Family Science website, and this will be there.